Voice of the Sea, learning from experts across the ocean.
Welcome to Voice of the Sea. In this episode, we're learning about fish ears and algae. We're in Guam, meeting the researchers who are studying the marine environment here. First, we'll find out why scientists here are harvesting the ear bones from fishermen's catches. Then, we'll meet scientists who are trying to identify and understand algae, which has confounded researchers for centuries with its endless varieties, shapes, life stages, and colors, all of which make it very hard to classify.
First, we meet with Eric Cruz. Eric is Chamorro, meaning that he is descended from Guam's indigenous people.
Bositasi.
Eric is also a researcher with the National Marine Fisheries Service. His work is centered around better understanding the marine environment and on developing management strategies that protect fisheries resources while still maintaining cultural practices.
We are at the Department of Agriculture's Division of Aquatics and Wildlife Resources.
What do you do for your job?
Well, there's two things that I'm involved in here on Guam. I'm part of the Marianas Trench Marine National Monument Program. Uh-huh. And I also run the commercial fisheries biosampling program here on Guam.
Wow, you wear many hats.
Yes.
Eric is going to show us how he investigates the life history of a fish. The first step is to remove the fish's otolith, or ear bone, which he will then use to estimate how old the fish is. This data, along with the other information he collects, will help him and other scientists track fish populations to better understand their growth and reproduction, ultimately improving management practices.
And maybe what's your most favorite part of your job?
Oh, getting dirty with fish.
And do we get to do some of that today?
Yes, we have some here in the cooler.
Oh boy. Yeah. And I see you're set up with all kinds of equipment. Do you want to give me a breakdown of what you have laid out?
Well, here we have our scale. Uh-huh. We use to measure, weigh fish. We have our measuring board. We have some tools here for life history sample extraction. We need to cut up the fish, so we have our knife, chisels to get through the bone to reach the otoliths, scissors to kind of cut out any membranes or any excess tissue. So we have forceps to help us remove the otoliths from inside the fish, and a probe to help us manipulate the otoliths so we can pull it out with the forceps. We also have a little paintbrush to clean off the otoliths.
So otoliths are the ear bones of the fish.
Yes. Here's an example of two small ones. In contrast, one of the bigger otoliths that I've collected was from a 160-pound eight-banded grouper, a deep-bottom.
Wow.
Grouper.
I never seen an ear bone anything like this. It's massive.
If you look at the smaller ones, you can barely see it, but when you look at those massive ones, it's like, wow. Well, the biggest fish that we've taken otoliths from was a 250-pound Goliath grouper, but in comparison, the otoliths are much smaller.
Really?
Yes, because this is a deep-bottom fish. The Goliath grouper is more shallow water.
Explain that to me. What is the fish using its ear bones to do?
What these do is they kind of help the fish with orientation. Like they let it know that it's swimming upright instead of swimming sideways or upside down. It also helps the fish sense vibrations in the water.
And you have a fish in that cooler we get to take a look at?
We do have just a small, well, not so small, but emperor fish.
Oh, he's a cutie.
This guy is a thumbprint emperor. You see the black thumbprint right there. This fish was caught a couple days ago, so the coloration has kind of faded a little bit, but there's a black thumbprint right there.
Mm-hmm. I want to do it too.
There are many, many ways of removing otoliths. I've seen ways where you cut down here, and then you can pull out the otoliths from, depending on how far back you cut. It'll be on the front side or on the back part of the body. The way I do it is I go through the operculum.
The operculum is the covering
gill
over
cover.
The gills.
Yes. The reason why I do that is because typically the fish I work on, I give it back to the market and they can still sell it because there isn't much physical damage to the fish, much cosmetic damage is a better term, because people here like their fish pretty. They don't want it mutilated, and they like their fish whole. They don't, compared to this, the mainland, you know, mainland they like fillets. Here, and with most Pacific islands, we like the whole body, you know, intact. So I'll lift up the operculum. Let me start with this side. Cut away at the gill arch. Expose the area where the otoliths are sitting. And you can kind of see that little bump right there behind the eye.
Yep.
Yeah, that's typically where they are. So use the chisel to chip away at that bone. The probe to kind of feel around for it. Sometimes you just gotta play with it to pull it out.
A little bit of finesse there.
Yeah. They can be very fragile, so you don't wanna chip away at the otolith itself. And there you go.
Wow. So, oh, it's big.
It really doesn't look like the fish has been tampered with, besides the cut on the bottom, which typically, you know, they're gonna want the cut on the bottom anyways, because they do ask the co-op to gill and cut the fish, so it still looks pretty. We clean it in ethanol. There's ethanol in that little cap.
So now that you put them in the ethanol and you've brushed them off, you're going to dry them out?
Yeah, what I do is just kind of blot it a little bit to get some of the excess ethanol, and then I'll store it overnight in these, well, they do get stored in these vials, but I'll leave the cap open so that it can dry out a little bit better. The University of Guam has done the life history work for this particular species, and they had found that the L50, which is the length at which 50% of the population are reproducing, is at about 21 centimeters. So this guy was about 24, so he is at a length where he has already reproduced. They've also aged the age at 50% reproduction to be about, I think it was 3.8 years. So it takes 3.8 years for this guy to start reproducing.
So based on how long he is, you can say that it's more or less more than 3.8 years old, probably.
Yeah, because from what they found was 3.8 years was about 20.8 centimeters. So this guy is about 2 or 3 centimeters longer than that. So he's been around a little bit longer than that.
Gotcha. Sometimes fishermen are reluctant. They don't want to collaborate with a scientist because maybe they're afraid or they don't know the scientific community. Mm-hmm. And what can you say about that?
You know, there are going to be limits. It's something that Congress has passed. The only way those limits will be beneficial to the fishermen is if they provide us with data. They're going to go off the best available data. And so if they're not providing that data, you know, to the scientists, we cannot use that data. So that everything that they catch is not going to be reported. It's not going to be part of the catch limits. So we're going to assume that they're not catching. So if you provide data to the scientists, you know, we can use that to help the fishermen instead of hurt the fishermen. I did grow up as a fisherman, so I want the best available data to be used to set these limits, because I don't want such low limits where I cannot even fish, you know?
Sure.
Yeah, so that's what I would say to fishermen who are reluctant to provide data. Just getting involved is the best thing that they could do.
To have a voice.
Yes. You know, there are organizations around Guam who advocate for fishermen. We have the Guam Fishermen's Co-op, we have the Guam Organization of Saltwater Anglers, we have the Micronesian Underwater Fishing Federation. Those groups really fight for the fishermen and not against them. Being on such a small island, you know, the only thing around you is the ocean. So growing up, I was just very fascinated with fish, you know, just from being a little boy, just even seeing one fish, you know, you get so excited. Yeah. And then growing up, going out fishing with my dad and my brother, my uncles, my love for fish just kept growing and growing. So that's kind of why I got into this field, is just because it was something I grew up with. It's a part of our culture. Fishing is a part of our culture, just like, you know, most cultures in the Pacific. And I don't want there to be overfishing, because I do want fish in the future. I do want fish for my children. I do want fish for my children's children, you know. So that's kind of what got me into this.
Very good. And what about our youngsters, our children who might be interested in growing up to be like you, Eric, to work in fishery science in a way that's productive and helping to maintain our fish populations? What do they need to do?
Well, they need to go to school. Going to school is, you know, finishing college, whether you want to be in marine biology or just general biology or anything for that matter, going to school is the best advice that I can give these children.
The Curriculum Research and Development Group in the College of Education at the University of Hawaii at Manoa. CRDG's training roots go back over 40 years. Through professional development programs, curriculum workshops, research on teaching methodology, individualized school and district training, and so much more. The Curriculum Research and Development Group, Improving Schools, Improving Education. CRDG.
Next, we're at the University of Guam with researchers Anna Simeon and Tom Schills. They're studying algae, which is unexpectedly complex and diverse. Our understanding of algae is changing as these scientists work to uncover a basic understanding of the world's algae population.
So Anna, you're a master's student here at the University of Guam, mm-hmm. in the Marine Lab, and you're studying different kinds of algae.
Yes,
simply. Algae is like an aquatic plant, right?
Yeah, so algae, it's exactly as you say it. I mean, just as we have trees and grasses on land, we have all different kinds of algae underneath the water. So, but it looks completely different from a lot of stuff that you see on land. So a lot of plants that you find underwater, you look at them and you don't necessarily think that they're plants. So that's something that's really cool, is that you look at all these different species that we have. It's really neat.
And so what makes them similar to plants then?
The basis of plant life is the ability to take sunlight and grow from it, make energy out of it, and be able to survive without actually ingesting any food like you humans do. And so plants, like underwater plants and plants on land, they have that same ability. So they grow from the sunlight.
They photosynthesize.
Yes.
Great. These guys here, they're not green like most of our land plants.
Mm-hmm.
Why is that?
Why? That's a really good question. So there's a whole bunch of different pigments that you're going to find in different kinds of algae. I mean, and so these, for instance, you see here, this is very red. And these have been dried out, so they look, you know, the coloration is going to be a little bit duller than what you might see underwater. But this, for instance, when you pull it out of the water, is bright red. It's this really beautiful, kind of really lovely branching type of plant. This one is actually kind of more of a brownish color underwater. But there's these pigments called phycobilins in there, and that actually gives the different color. And this one's really neat underwater because it has kind of an iridescence to it, so it kind of shimmers as you look at it. Mm-hmm. It's really very cool.
As a scientist, why would you make an algae press?
One reason, for example, when you have something that's been dried out like this, it actually preserves the DNA for a long time. And so if it's kept dry and if it's not spoiled by some other chemical or something, I mean, you can keep these for, you know, decades.
I didn't realize that. Yeah. So you would be able to extract DNA from that and do genetic studies from the herbarium press.
Yeah, yeah.
And I know we have herbarium presses that go back hundreds of years.
Yeah, so if they've been properly maintained, then
you... That is so cool.
Yeah, it's really very cool. And then on top of that, when you're looking at, you know, changes over time are a very important thing in marine ecosystems and conservation, and especially in evolution and genetic studies as well. So it's really good to be able to have old, like herbarium specimens from hundreds of years ago, because you can see how things have changed. You can see how different types may look differently in different areas of the world. And so it's another diagnostic tool, really, because, you know, this will last for a long time and you can look at all the diagnostic characters that it has. And yeah, it's really, it's great for taxonomy and it's great for, you know, like I said, genetic studies.
Very cool. And you have some more recently living specimens that we can take a look at too?
Yeah, I collected some just out in Pago Bay here a couple hours ago.
So how did you do your collection?
You hop in the water and you grab what you see. That's pretty easy, but I just, you know, you take plastic bags with you and you go into the water and you just, I mean, this stuff is everywhere on the reefs, absolutely everywhere. So you just walk out and you have dozens of species, if not more, just right at your fingertips. So it's easy to do.
Let's take a look at some.
Okay. All of these were collected out of the reef flat down in Pago Bay, which basically means it's the portion of the reef that's closest to the land and it's very shallow. So this was only in like 3 feet of water.
Okay.
I wanted to go deeper today, but the waves are too big and I didn't feel like getting tumbled. The one that I was just showing with the press is this one right here. And this is called a Liagara, or at least I think it's a Liagara. This is one of those species one of the genera, groups, families that are really tough to identify. Really tough. I actually was going to do my thesis on these, but they're really hard to see. So the different species will have, the only characteristics that you're going to notice differently are under the microscope and at the genetic level. And even then it's really tough to tell. So
it feels, I have a hard time even explaining how it feels. It sort of feels like wet spaghetti. It's a little bit slimy, but it has some substance. Mm-hmm. It's really neat. Oh, there's the guy moving around.
Oh, yeah. We have, and in the algae, there's all, oh, there you go. We have all sorts of little critters that hang out in the algae. So this looks like a little amphipod, a little mm-hmm. crustacean. So, yeah, so we have all sorts. And what else do we have? One is, oh, where'd that go? Here we go. Like for one of the gals here is doing her study on brittle stars. And so whenever I find brittle stars hanging out in the algae, I collect them for her so she can she can do that.
Oh, he's a cute guy.
Yeah, he's a neat little one.
So the algae is providing a habitat for other organisms to live in?
Yeah, lots of different organisms. I mean, tons. it's really important.
Exploring Our Fluid Earth is the dynamic curriculum developed by the University of Hawaii's Curriculum Research and Development Group. The award-winning Fluid Earth and Living Ocean textbooks are now interactive and online. New activities, updated content, and a teacher community. Exploring Our Fluid Earth is now freely available. Find out more at exploringourfluidearth.org. We're at the University of Guam with researchers Anna Simeon and Tom Schills.
Let's take a look at what else you have here.
Okay, what else do we have? So one that you might be familiar with in Hawaii is the Acanthophora. And this one is the one that was, it's the invasive that you guys are probably, well, more familiar with than you'd like to be, I suppose.
That is true. It is invasive in Hawaii.
Yeah. So, and so we have it here, but it hasn't become as much a problem as it has for you guys.
This alga has in fact been documented when it arrived in Hawaii, when it was established too. Mm-hmm. It was in the 50s, I believe, when a barge from Guam made its way to Honolulu. So, and then it got established there. And recently it's becoming much more a species of concern because it's like in the Marshall Islands, just 3 years ago, it arrived for the first time in the Marshall Islands, and it was like, it's overtaking now vast extents of benthic substrate, basically. Basically, it's competing with coral over there, like it is kind of in Hawaii. And then now also in the Line Islands, some of the most isolated islands in the world, basically. It did arrive there too now recently, like a year ago or so.
Why is it not a problem so much in Guam, but a problem in these other places?
Because it's, that's, I mean, it's expected to be native to Guam.
I see.
So it's part of the native flora of Guam. And the Hawaiian flora is very different from our flora, so to speak. You've got lots more endemics. Basically, the isolation through evolutionary time of the Hawaiian Islands has evolved the flora into be a very particular flora with lots of unique species.
So as a student in school, you sometimes think that all the science has already been done. But the reality is very different than that. The ocean's really unexplored, even in these shallow areas.
Just as an example, a couple of months ago, a researcher from DAWR, Division of Aquatic and Wildlife Resources, came to me and they found the green turtle dead in the harbor. It's a protected species. And they wanted to do a gut content analysis. And when I started looking, it was like two algae that were very dominantly present in the gut content. One of them was a new record for the island, never seen. So we're doing lots of surveys, and especially in the harbor, because there's a lot of construction activities going. So we've got very detailed surveys done there, but relatively shallow, up to, let's say, 20 meters or something. And then the other species in there, I cannot even like identify to order level, because it was not reproductive. And these were the two algae that were specifically targeted by this protected species. So, although we've got this rich history of algal exploration in the islands, and although we've got well-documented the morphospecies concept, there's still lots of discoveries to be made. And I mean, we're now right in the midst of James Cameron going down the trench. But what for us, algal phycologists, we're not that interested that deep because we're interested in the photic zone. But it wouldn't surprise me, for example, if he would have like in his busy schedule a little bit of time to explore the waters between 100 and 300 meters, let's say 250, 300, if he focuses, I assume they could add also the record of the deepest alga. They could have so much more new species to be discovered in this shallow zone, although it's very exciting what they do, of course, in the deep sea. it's very important work, but just to say that even at shallower depths, we're still kind of like unraveling all the diversity that surrounds us and also which has important ecological consequences for that matter. To date, we haven't fully recognized all the diversity, the number of species, so to speak, for given areas. They recognize that we are just still in the linear part of the curve, basically. We're basically, the more we sample, the more we discover.
Thanks for watching Voice of the Sea.
Turn your love of the ocean into a lifelong career. Join NOAA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, as we unlock the secrets in the deep oceans, track rapidly moving storms, model climate trends, protect and preserve our marine resources, and so much more. It's all in a day's work at NOAA. Find a career that makes a world of difference, enriching life through science, service, and stewardship. NOAA. University of Hawaii Sea Grant College Program, focused on Hawaii's coasts and its communities through sustainable development, safe seafood supply, sustainable coastal tourism, hazard resilience, and healthy coastal ecosystems. Hawaii's Sea Grant.
Kosi Island Earth, bringing together university, government, research, and community partners to improve science education and ocean stewardship in Hawaii.